Can you hear me if I'm talking about this volume?
There are still a couple of seats at the front. If you can find out halfway through, you can't hear them. Move forward a little bit.
Yeah, I apologize. My voice isn't very loud, but I'll try my best to.
This is though.
Yeah, so as I go along, feel free to interrupt me if you need clarification or have any questions. And then there should be plenty of time for questions at the end as well. So I'm guessing probably most of you are at least somewhat familiar with chytridiomycosis, but I'll talk a little bit about that and why it's such a big problem, and then talk about what I'm hoping that we're working to do to try to restore frogs that are threatened by this disease to the wild. So most of you probably know amphibians are the most threatened group of vertebrates, and one of the main threats to this group is the disease chytridiomycosis. So this is the skin disease of amphibians, and it's caused by two different fungal pathogens referred to as BD and B-sal. B-sal tends to mainly infect salamanders and is not yet found in Australia, and so this talk will be mainly concerning BD. So this is the worst infectious disease ever recorded in vertebrates, and is believed to have originated in Asia and is now a problem for amphibians worldwide, and is believed to have been spread globally by the amphibian trade. In Australia, it's believed that BD was introduced through the port of Brisbane around 1978, and subsequently spread north and south down the coast of Australia, and caused at least six species to go extinct, including the southern gastric rooting frog. And at the moment, there's at least seven other species that are at high risk of extinction and requiring some type of intervention to prevent extinction. So chytrid is a major conservation challenge, and this is unique compared to some other threats like habitat loss or poaching, because it's impossible to eradicate from the environment as far as we know. And so, and because of this, you cannot just preserve habitat to preserve amphibians threatened by chytridiomycosis. In fact, many of the declines from chytridiomycosis occur in pristine habitats. So it's a very hard problem to solve. And various restoration methods have been attempted or proposed. I've listed a few of those here. So we've known about this disease for over 20 years now. Many things have been proposed, tried, with varying degrees of success. But the problem with most of these things is that many of them have unintended impacts, or they're not self-sustaining. So they're something that might have to be reapplied every year. So for instance, vaccination, if that was shown to be effective, it would have to be done every single year. So very expensive and time-consuming to do. So far, the most effective method at preventing extinction from chytridiomycosis is conservation breeding. And this has prevented many species from going extinct, including the corroborative frogs that I'm going to talk about today. And right now, there's about 200 species of amphibians that are dependent upon these worldwide. But unfortunately, the majority of reintroduction efforts from these captive bred amphibians tend to fail because the chytrid fungus cannot be eradicated from the environment. And so it's very challenging because, you know, these were just supposed to be a stopgap to keep amphibians from going extinct. But ideally, we want them to be back in the wild where they can fulfill their ecosystem services. And also, as you imagine, it's very expensive to keep amphibians in captivity. So not ideal in many ways. And kind of the key thing that I'm going to be talking about today is these breeding programs, basically how they work is they attempt to freeze the genetic diversity of the founders. And this is great if you're dealing with a threat like habitat loss that might be able to be reversed. But in the case of chytridiomycosis, this approach does not allow the frogs to potentially adapt to become more resistant to the fungus and eventually be able to survive in the wild. So as I said, conservation breeding programs are really good at preventing extinction, but then we come up with the question of then. So what do we? How do we create self-sustaining populations of species when the chytrid fungus cannot be eradicated from the wild? And this has been a major question ever since the fungus was discovered. And as I said, amphibians are a very important component of the ecosystem. So they're an important predator for insects, they're very important for transferring nutrients, and so on. So their removal and just living in zoos indefinitely is not an ideal situation for either the people that have to take care of them, the amphibians, or the ecosystems. One approach that we've come up with is known as, is using genetic intervention to try to increase the fitness of the amphibians in the presence of the fungus. And there's two main categories of genetic intervention. The first and the more commonly used is known as genetic rescue. And this is basically when you attempt to increase the genetic diversity of your population to make them more resilient. And if you're successful, if your genetic intervention method is successful, you will see changes in population size after the intervention. And the next approach is one that our group recently termed, which is known as targeted genetic intervention. And so this is a bit different because we're not just increasing or attempting to maintain genetic diversity, but what we're trying to do is increase the prevalence of alleles that confer fitness, especially in the presence of chytrid fungus. And so I'm going to refer to targeted genetic intervention as TGI throughout the rest of this talk. And basically how this works is it increases fitness in the animal by promoting genetic change. And this approach can be applied to either hosts or symbionts, so even possibly the animal's microbiome. But what I'm going to be talking about today is the application of TGI to the hosts or the amphibians. And it can be done by various different methods. I've listed three approaches that we discuss in our paper here, which are synthetic biology, artificial selection, and targeted gene flow. And so synthetic biology approaches work by modifying the genetic features of the organism by genetic engineering, and I'll provide a figure to explain that better here in a second. Artificial selection induces genetic change by selective breeding. So this is a method commonly used in livestock and companion animals like dogs, so something that's been used by humans successfully for thousands of years. And then lastly, targeted gene flow, which is when you move animals that have beneficial phenotypes into populations where they're declining. And so none of these methods that we've adapted for TGI are new. As I said, they've been used for millennia for humans, especially selective breeding, to produce many of our livestock and companion animals. They're also commonly used in model organisms, such as African clawed frogs, for research purposes, and to, for instance, understand human medical conditions. But they're also being trialed for conservation, or at least they've been proposed. And so the organism that's closest to release is the American chestnut tree, which I've shown here. And this used to be a dominant tree in American forests until the chestnut blight was introduced. And it's more or less extinct in the wild today. And so they've actually genetically engineered chestnut trees to be tolerant of the chestnut blight and are currently seeking regulatory approval to begin some trial releases, hopefully in the next couple of years. So this will probably be the first application of this for conservation, and will hopefully pave the way for the frog research and a lot of the other research that is starting to take off. And then many of you, are also familiar with coral bleaching, being from Australia, and it is also being considered for this. So they're attempting to selectively breed the coral, the microbes of the coral, and also genetically engineer it as well. So in the coral's case, it's for heat tolerance, and in our case, for disease resistance. So basically how TGI works If you have a frog that has a blue allele, which is beneficial, and one that has that lacks it and is susceptible, what we want to do is increase the number of the blue alleles. This is very simplified, but more or less kind of gets across the point. So synthetic biology is a really great approach because it works even if your species completely lacks resistance. So in this case, you can actually take genes from resistant species and put them in your frogs that are susceptible and potentially increase resistance. The next is artificial selection. As I said, this is the most long used and probably would be a more widely accepted approach. And in this case, you just target individuals in your breeding program that have your beneficial alleles to increase their frequency in your population. And then lastly, targeted gene flow, and this is being trialed in quolls in Australia right now. So basically, if you have a population that has your advantageous phenotype, so for instance, if you have a population that's known to be chytrid resistant, and then you have another one that isn't, and then you know the genetic basis of this, you can actually translocate animals that have this resistant into the susceptible population and potentially but for this to work, and also for the artificial selection, animals actually, there has to be resistance alleles present in the population to begin with. So some of the basic requirements of the TGI approach is that you have to first understand the genetic basis of resistance in order to be able to manipulate the frogs. And this requires extensive genomic resources. So this includes things like having high quality reference genomes for both resistant and susceptible species so you can begin to understand what is conferring resistance. And then also having things like matched phenotype and genotype information. So next I'm going to talk about some of the research that my group is doing to try to understand the genetic basis of resistance. Before that though, as I said, one of the things you need are amphibian reference genomes. So this is the accumulation of amphibian reference genomes through time. It's a little bit outdated. I have it added in 2023 now. But interestingly, the generation of amphibian reference genomes is lagging behind that of other groups. So as of when I made this summary about 6 months ago, there are about 750 mammal reference genomes, 750 bird reference genomes, 400 mammal genomes, and about 100 reptiles. So you can see amphibians a lot less. And so this makes a lot of these approaches very challenging to do if you don't have the initial resources required. Luckily for us, we worked with the Vertebrate Genome Project and just had the Southern Corroboree Frog Reference Genome assembled in February of 2023. And so this is the first myobatrachid genome and also one of our focal species. So quite exciting for us to finally have this. And there's also been, since I created this figure, 13 new genomes that have been published on NCBI. So, even though it's really the amphibian reference genomes are lagging behind other species, they're really starting to grow astronomically. For us. And you might ask, well, why are amphibians so neglected compared to other animals? And if you're not aware, it's pretty crazy looking at the size of amphibian genomes. So looking across vertebrates, amphibians have the largest range of genome size in vertebrates. So they can be very small, as much as about 1 gigabyte, to well over 100 gigabases. So huge range, and these large genomes are very expensive to sequence and to work with. New sequencing technologies, known as long-read sequencing, are making this much easier and much more feasible. So that's why we're starting to see a lot more amphibian genomes compared to the past. And this is just another quick figure. So there's actually a database known as GOAT. I recommend checking it out if you haven't already. So the really cool thing about goat is not only can you see all of the amphibian genomes that have been assembled, but you can see those that are underway and who's actually doing them. So when I looked at this, you can see there's quite a few, and quite a few of these are myobatrachids, like corroborate frogs, which is quite exciting for me. So these are probably due to be out sometime in 2023, 2024. We should have more than double the amphibian reference genomes than what we currently have, which is quite exciting for anyone working with amphibians, I think. And so one of the things we've done recently is just looked at the publicly available amphibian genomes. And kind of an interesting feature is that they vary considerably in quality. So this is looking at the completeness of the genomes from the perspective of BUSCOs, which are highly conserved genes. And what you're going to take from this figure is the blue bars are those that are complete, and the red are those that are incomplete. And so as you can see, the highest quality genome at the top is Xenopus tropicalis, but as we go down, they vary quite a bit in quality. And why does this matter for us conservation biologists? Well, it matters because if you want to understand what's causing something like disease resistance, you need a really high quality and complete genome. Otherwise, many of the genes, especially immune genes, which are very troubling to deal with, are probably going to be missing. And so this is definitely an issue that you have to consider when selecting your genome to work with if you want it to be high quality. And so definitely worth evaluating for your species and trying to get as high a quality genome as possible if you can. Okay, so now moving on to our work in corroboree frogs. Our plan is to try to test the application of TGI approaches in this species. And so we currently have funding to first understand the genetic basis of chytrid immunity in corroboree frogs, and then try to test some of these TGI approaches in this species. And so many of you probably know quite a bit about corroboree frogs, but just in case you don't, there's two species of corroboree frogs, the northern and southern corroboree frog. And these species are endemic to the snowy mountains of Australia. So they have a very small range. And they suffered mass declines once BD moved into the region. This caused the southern corroboree frog to go functionally extinct. And the northern corroboree frog has held on a bit longer. And in fact, the conservation managers weren't super concerned about it, or at least not as concerned as the Southerns. But recently there's been several La Nina years in a row, and the population has actually started to decline. So unfortunately they are probably going to be functionally extinct in the next few years as well, which is very sad. As I said, initially we were mainly going to focus on the southern corroboree frogs, but now we're going to start working with the northerns as well, because we need to understand how different they are, and possibly if they have any differences in resistance. So I'll talk about that here in a minute. But luckily for both of these species, there are extensive captive breeding programs in place, which has prevented extinction. And most of these are run by Taronga Conservation Society and Zoos Victoria. And so they've been absolutely amazing conservation partners for us. They're helping fund a lot of our research, and they've provided us with hundreds of frogs to do this, which has been quite an amazing thing, because it would be very hard for us to do this work without their help. Now what we're doing is trying to study the genetic basis of resistance. So first I'll talk a little bit about the southern corroborees, and then I'll move on to what the northern work will be. And so what we've done up to this time is we've evaluated whether or not there's any differences in resistance in the corroboree frogs. And these infection studies were actually done by Laura Branley during her PhD at James Cook University, where she looked at population differences in chytrid. So what she saw is that there were differences in survival among the populations, and that also differences in infection. So this indicates that this species might actually have some heritable resistance for chytridiomycosis, which is great, because it means that we might be able to use TGI to try to increase it. But the problem with that study is it was very small, only about 70 animals, and so it was not powered well enough to do to actually understand the genomic basis of resistance. And so that's what we're hoping to look at now. And so my PhD student, Nikki Davidson, which many of you probably have met, is the one running this study. And so for this, we're hoping to have about 1,000 frogs total from about 30 different families. And we expose them to the chytridiomycosis and studying the genetic basis of resistance. And so in these frogs, we expose them to the disease, and then we measure various different traits, like pathogenoid, survival, change in body condition, and so on. Then the next step will be doing what's known as a genome-wide association study. And this is where we explore the heritability and what's known as the genetic architecture of resistance. And genetic architecture is just simply the number of genes involved and their effects. And so this is an example of some Manhattan plots from cattle. And so in these, you can see the animal's chromosome is on the y-axis, it's on the x-axis, and the significance is on the y. And so the top trait is basically what's known as a simple trait. So only a couple genes impacted. Whereas the one on the bottom is impacted by many genes. And you might wonder why that matters. Well, that matters because it impacts the intervention method that we use. So if it's only impacted by a couple of genes, then we can just use an approach like genetic engineering to just tweak the frogs and change a couple of genes. But if it's impacted by hundreds of genes, which is more likely to be the case, because that's what's seen in immunity in other organisms, then approaches such as artificial selection might be more beneficial because you can actually change many hundreds of genes at once. And so we're exploring this right now and hopefully be able to report back to you in a year or so. Hopefully Nikki will be giving a talk about this. So stay tuned. So that's basically a genome-wide approach to looking at this. And we're also looking at it from another angle. So Dan, who's here tonight, is going to be looking at gene expression and how that changes over the course of infection to hopefully come up with another, or this would be another approach for trying to identify the genes of resistance. And so this is an example from a study in alpine tree frogs. And basically what was found is that certain populations responded differently to infection. And if you notice this orange one here, they seem to not have very high infection loads and reduce infection over time. And so what Dan's hoping to look at is if you see these patterns in the southern corroborate frogs, see if those also correspond to changes in gene expression. And those genes that are either upregulated or downregulated would be great targets for genetic intervention. And the other thing he's going to be looking at is whether age impacts susceptibility. So strangely, no one's actually looked at this before. It's always been thought that the younger frogs are more susceptible, but we don't actually know that. And that's really important for the reintroduction program, because whatever age group is more resistant might be the better one for the reintroduction efforts. So that's something we'll be exploring as well. And also how age impacts gene expression. So that's another thing to stay tuned for as well. And Melissa, who is also here, is going to be doing a lot of this in northern corroborate frogs. So as I said, northern corroborate frogs have declined much more slowly than southerns. And some people think this is because they might be more resistant to the cold. But we can't know until we actually evaluate this, because there could be environmental differences which have allowed them to persist for longer. So it's important to know if they differ in susceptibility. And one of the reasons for this is that it's been proposed that you could potentially hybridize the species to increase resistance in the southern. So this is a bit controversial, and whether or not we'll ever try it, I'm not sure, but it could be something that we could evaluate in the lab if they're found to be more resistant. So Melissa will be comparing the two species to see if they differ in susceptibility. So she might see something like this curve, where one species survives a lot longer than the other. or we might not see any fields. We will find out. The other thing she's going to be looking at is gene expression. So we will be able to compare the two species, if they're different, and if their gene expression patterns. And so this is an example of how you look at gene expression from two North American granite frogs. And so on the left we have the wood frog, which is susceptible to chytridiomycosis. And then here we have the bullfrog. And what you can see is that over time, the wood frog has really bright yellow colors. This is indicating that they have a lot of genes that are overexpressed. And again, this is the more susceptible species. So these are some of the comparisons that we will be doing to not only compare the two species, but also potentially identify genes that are conferring resistance in these two species. Okay, so I'll try to wrap up here. Why do we care about this? Well, ideally, we want to be able to link the genotypes of the animals to the phenotypes, which are resistance. And a great way to do this is using the intermediate of gene expression. And so you might be wondering how all of this fits together. Unfortunately, the way I see it, this TGI process is quite a long-term process. So even though it's definitely something that we need to try, it's something that is going to require considerable resources and a lot of caution to make sure that it's done safely. So we would start by characterizing the genetic basis of resistance. From there we can determine the best approach and start to perform this in the lab. Once we've done that, then we would actually have to evaluate in the lab whether or not it's efficacious. So are these interventions increasing resistance? From there we would move on to screening the animals to ensure that our changes are not causing any off-target impacts. And this would first be done in the lab, but then would immediately have to move to the field. And then, if everything proceeds as we're hoping, then starting with limited releases and then widespread release. And this would all be, of course, pending regulatory and community approval, which I'm not really touching on today, but it would be quite an extensive process as well. And then lastly, really quickly, we're also looking at methods to improve the corroborated frog breeding program. And so right now, they're actually suffering about 50% mortality in the captive bred frogs, so we're trying to understand what will be the cause of that. So this could be things like disease, it could be poor fertilization success, and even things like genetic incompatibility. So I have a master's student, Sally Gazzard, who's working on that. All right, so then kind of summing things up, why TGI? It might sound very complicated and expensive, but right now we think this may be the most promising solution for restoring amphibians threatened by this unique threat of chytrids in the wild. So as I said, this cannot be eradicated, and so this method could potentially produce self-sustaining populations of frogs that can be restored to the wild. And the additional benefit is once these frogs are restored to the wild, they will restore their ecosystem services instead of having to live in a zoo in perpetuity. However, it's not without its challenges. One of the things if you think about genetics, is the trade-off between something being highly adaptive and losing adaptive potential. So if we're selecting frogs for certain traits, they're going to lose some of the standing genetic diversity. So that risk will have to be evaluated. But we think it's worth trying because at the moment the species cannot persist in the wild. So what are we really going to lose? Either we live in the zoo or we're going to try to attempt this and hopefully can restore them. As I said, considerable resources have to be invested in understanding the genetic basis so that can be manipulated. We have to work on the regulatory requirements and making sure the public approves of these potentially controversial approaches, and then various resources for evaluating safety and efficacy. So in conclusion, chytridiomycosis presents a major conservation challenge, and we think that TGI might be a promising solution for allowing frogs to survive alongside this threat. However, it does require extensive resources, which we're working on developing. And so one of the last things I wanted to say is I've recently launched the Amphibian Genomics Consortium to try to build up these resources. And And so if you're interested in amphibian genomics, conservation, ecology, evolution, please join us. I can send you the link, or here's the Scantron link. But basically what we're hoping to do is fund and build these genomic resources, build the tools, and also build a community of people that are interested in using them for conservation applications. And so if you're at all interested, we're going to be having our first virtual meeting on April 14th. Right now we have about 140 members internationally, so I think it's going to be a really good group. So I'm very excited to see how that pans out. And please join us if you have any interest in that. And so, yeah, I'll just finish by thanking all of the members of my research group, the various wildlife partners at Zoos Victoria, and Dave Hunter has been amazing for helping us with this, and various other people who've helped and supported this research. And thank you very much for Frogs Victoria for the chance to talk to you tonight.